Hi. Now, in this lecture, we will talk about dehydration of alcohols and we'll look into its mechanism also. Now, dehydration, we know dehydration, D means removal, hydration means water, right? So, dehydration of alcohols means removal of water from alcohols, right? Now, in order to remove water, we need something that can remove water, right, from alcohol. So, what we'll employ here is in this reaction, is a dehydrating agent, right? Concentrated sulfuric acid is a dehydrating agent, so we can use concentrated sulfuric acid to dehydrate alcohols, right? Now we'll look into different products that can get formed as a result of dehydration of alcohols, right, depending on various conditions, right? And then we'll also see, in case different products can form, which product will prevail as per Zaitsev's rule. We'll discuss Zaitsev's rule also here, and then we'll see what type of alcohols will undergo dehydration most easily. We know there are primary, secondary, tertiary alcohols, so which one will undergo dehydration most easily, that we'll also discuss here. So first thing is dehydration of alcohols. Dehydration means removal of water, removal of water. Right, if I'll take a simple alcohol, CH3CH2OH, this is ethanol, right? And alcohol dehydration can be done in two ways. First is by heating with concentrated sulfuric acid, right? And second way is by passing alcohol over heated alumina. Alumina, we know alumina is aluminium oxide, Al2O3, right? So these are the two ways. First we'll look at the first reaction with concentrated sulfuric acid, right? So the reaction takes place at 443 Kelvin when alcohol, ethanol, is heated with concentrated sulfuric acid, right? This concentrated sulfuric acid will remove water molecule, right? We know water is H and OH, H2O, so it will remove hydrogen and OH, right? And it will form this product, and this product we know is, since this is removed, you get a double bond here. This is your ethene, right? So alkene will get formed as a result of dehydration of alcohols. Now suppose if I take excess of alcohol, right? If excess of alcohol is taken, in presence of excess of alcohol, product is your ether. A different kind of organic compound will get formed. If alcohol is in excess, the product is ether, right? This compound will get formed, right? We'll see the reaction, how this product will get formed, right? Now we'll just look into some various things that takes place as while this dehydration of alcohol takes place, right? Now since the alcohol position is here, right, in this type of alcohol, this is the only product, only one type of alkene can get formed, which is this. Now suppose we have a different type of alcohol, and which is CH3 CH2 CHOH, right, and your CH3, right? After this also we have one CH3. Now you can just look at the position of OH with respect to the two alkyl groups, right? This is also an alkyl group, this alkyl group and this CH2, right? Since here you have only one carbon atom, right? From adjacent carbon atoms, water molecule is removed. Right, from adjacent carbon atoms, you can see this and this are adjacent carbon atoms. One OH is removed from here, one OH is H is removed from here. Sorry. Now suppose in this direction also, here also you have one carbon atom, right, that contains a hydrogen atom. So there are chances that hydrogen will get removed from here as well as from here, right, resulting into the formation of different products which are isomers, which may be isomers, right. So here if you look at this compound, this is the OH that will get removed for sure in dehydration. Now this is the adjacent carbon atom, this is also an adjacent carbon atom, so hydrogen can be removed from here, right, resulting into two different products, right. Now which product will prevail, we'll see that. Suppose this one is removed first, let's say, so product that will get formed would be CH, this is removed, now CH is left, CH3, right. Now suppose this will get removed, suppose hydrogen from this carbon atom will get removed, now let's see what compound will get formed, CH3, CH2, CH, right. Now since hydrogen is getting removed from here, a double bond will come here, CH2, right. This is 1, 2, 3, 4. This is your 2-butene. This is your 1-butene. Right? If you remember, we have done this type of reaction in haloalkanes, right? Where this Cl group, there instead of OH, we have Cl group. Right, position of Cl group, if you remember beta elimination, we did beta elimination, right, where in that reaction also that we have studied in alcohols, I'm sorry, in alkyl halides, we have two carbon atoms, right, adjacent to this carbon atom that carried Cl there, but here we have OH, right. So hydrogen can be removed from here, it can be removed from here, and it is forming two alkenes. So which one will predominate? The one which is more substituted, right? And this is the rule of Zaitsev. This is Zaitsev rule, right? Or Zaitsev rule, right? So the one which is more substituted will prevail or will predominate, would be the major product. So here, which one, if you look at this, which one is more substituted? The one which contains more carbon, more alkyl groups or less hydrogen atoms. Right, you can see this contains more alkyl groups, 2-butene, as compared to this, it contains only this alkyl group. It contains one alkyl group, whereas the other one, it contains two alkyl groups. Right, this contains two alkyl groups, this contains one alkyl groups. So this one is more substituted. This one is more substituted. And will be formed as a major product, right? This would be major product. This would be around 80%, right? As per Zaitsev rule. Zaitsev's rule, remember this rule, this is important, right? And this one is less substituted, right? How will you see which one is more substituted? The one that contains more number of alkyl groups and less number of hydrogen atoms. Since this contains more number of alkyl groups, so this is more substituted and would be formed as a major product as per Zaitsev rule, right? This is important. Now let's look into the mechanism of this reaction, right? Mechanism, will take this example, right? So here in mechanism, we have taken, this is protonic, right? We know that sulfuric acid is protonic. It can give proton, right? So it will donate one proton to alcohol group. Right, it will donate one proton to alcohol group, right? Since CH3. This is your OH. Sorry, let's write it. Right, it will donate. The first step would be since I said let's write it over here. Donation of proton. Right, and who will donate proton? Sulfuric acid. Right, CH3, CH2, OH. This is how exactly the alcohol structure looks like. You have two alcohol group, you have two lone pair of electrons on oxygen atom. When proton would be donated by sulfuric acid, it will attach itself to this oxygen atom through this lone pair of electron, right, forming right, this is what will get formed, right. Now it has only one lone pair plus, from where this plus sign came, from this proton, right. And this proton, since we know it is deficient of electrons, it will attach through this lone pair of electrons. So it has got two electrons. Now in the second step, this is the first step, in the second step it will lose this water molecule. We know that water is a good leaving group, right? It can be lost easily. So it will form a carbocation. Right, this will get lost easily. Minus H2O. Since water is a good leaving group, so it will leave, right, and a carbocation will get formed. So from this we conclude that dehydration of alcohol goes through an intermediate, and intermediate is carbocation. And we know that carbocations, these intermediates, are short-lived, they are very reactive, so whatever they will find, they will react with it, right. Or what they will do, if this is your carbocation, right. Now this carbocation, right, what it will do is, in the third step, this carbocation will lose a proton, right. This carbocation will lose a proton in the third step to form more stable alkene, right. The third step would be, let's write it like this. Right, here it will lose a proton. This proton, we know that this is less stable. As I said, this is an intermediate which is short-lived and ready to react, as we have studied before. So right, since this is highly unstable, so it will lose a proton to form stable alkene. We know that alkene is more stable as compared to this carbocation. Right, and this is the product. Right, let's just quickly recap mechanism. We have three steps in mechanism. The first step is the protonating step, where sulfuric acid will donate a proton, right, to form this compound, right, and this proton will coordinate to this oxygen atom via this lone pair. And now it will lose this water molecule in the second step, because water is a good leaving group, to form this carbocation. In the third step, this carbocation will lose this proton to form more stable alkene, right. This is its mechanism. Now if alcohol is in excess, like I said before, that if we take alcohol in excess, then instead of an alkene, it will form an ether. Like here, if excess of alcohol is taken, product is ether. Now let's see how that will form. Like when we take, let's look, I'm just directly taking you to the mechanism of that reaction, right. And we know that your ethers are, that contains O group, right. ethers contain your O group. And the product, just look at the formula. This is an ether. Right, this is how ether looks like, or in simple ways, this is your ethoxyethane. Now let's see how this product will get formed. Till this point it's same, right? Till second point, mechanism is same. Now if alcohol is in excess, then to this carbocation, second molecule of alcohol will attack or react, right? We know that this is your alcohol, right? Through this oxygen atom, since oxygen atom has a lone pair of electrons, right? And this carbon atom is devoid of electrons, or what we say is deficient of electrons. So this alcohol molecule can attack at this deficient carbon atom to form oxonium ion, right? This the third step, in case we have alcohol in excess, right, would be that to this a second molecule of alcohol will attack, right? This molecule of alcohol will attack. This is an unprotonated alcohol, right? This is not protonated like in first step that we had, right? And it will form a oxonium ion, right? So to this, it will form CH3CH2, right? From here, you have O, right? OH, then the rest of the molecule have CH3CH2 plus, right? You already have plus sign here, so it will remain. Now we need this. Right now, this is an oxonium ion. We call it as oxonium ion. Why ion? It has a positive charge. Now this oxonium ion in the fourth step will lose a proton, this proton, right, to form an ether. Sorry, three. Right, this is an ether. It will lose a proton, minus proton, to form this ether. This is your ether, right? I hope this is clear. Just remember the mechanism of both these reactions, right? Now suppose in this mechanism also we need to understand one more thing, right? Just remember till this point where a carbocation is get formed, right? Now from here, okay, this thing is clear, that if we have taken excess of alcohol, an ether will get formed. And remember, since we are saying excess of alcohol, so here two alcohol molecules react to give you an ether molecule, right? This ether molecule is formed from two molecules of alcohol, whereas this ethene molecule, or both these ethene alkenes, are formed from one alcohol molecules, right? Since alcohol is in excess, so two molecules of alcohol can react to give you ether, right? Excess means more alcohol means two alcohol molecules will react. So the first two steps would be same. A carbocation will get formed. In case of excess of alcohols, this carbocation molecule would be attacked by the second molecule of alcohol, right, to form an oxonium ion. Now this oxonium ion will lose this proton to form this ether, right? Till this point it is clear. Now we'll look into what type of alcohols will undergo dehydration easily. we call it as ease of dehydration. Before understanding the ease of dehydration, you should know the stability of carbocations, right? We know that 3 degree carbocations, right, are more stable compared to 2 degree carbocations, and 2 degree carbocations are more stable compared to 1 degree carbocation. This is 3 degree, 2 degree, 1 degree, right? Now the same order is followed by alcohol dehydration. Same order would be formed by alcohol dehydration, right? If you take secondary, if you are doing dehydration of tertiary alcohol that contains, which is a 3 degree alcohol, it will result into the formation of a 3 degree carbocation, which is more stable, right? So it, since it is more stable, so it will undergo dehydration more easily, right? If you take 2 degree carbocation, it will undergo dehydration less easily compared to 3 degree alcohol. Why? Because it will form a carbocation which is 2 degree carbocation, right, which is less stable compared to 3 degree carbocation, right? So ease of dehydration depends on the stability of intermediate formed in the alcohol dehydration, right? So ease of dehydration depends on stability of carbocation formed in the reaction, right? So more stable the carbocation that will get formed, right, the more easily that alcohol will get formed. And we know that stability of carbocation follows this order. 3 degree carbocation, this carbocation is most stable, right? So tertiary alcohols will undergo dehydration most easily, right? So order of dehydration of alcohols also follow this order, right? So tertiary alcohols will undergo, tertiary alcohols are 3 degree alcohols, will undergo dehydration most easily. Then comes your secondary alcohols, then comes your primary alcohols, right? And what is the reason? Because the reason is that tertiary alcohol will form a carbocation which is most stable, right? That is why it will easily undergo dehydration, right? So I hope this point is clear, right? The other way you can dehydrate alcohol is, and when we say it will undergo dehydration most easily, we mean that if you take tertiary alcohol, let's look into the dehydration of a tertiary alcohol, right? Let me just rub this off first. Tertiary alcohol, when we say it undergoes dehydration most easily, that means less temperature is required, right? Less temperature and less concentrated acid would be required, right? Now let's look into what is the temperature condition, right? Temperature required would be around 358 with tertiary alcohols, right? And concentration would be 20 CH3. This is, we know, is a tertiary alcohol, right? Here this is a primary alcohol, right? So here temperature was 443 and concentration of sulfuric acid was 90%. If you have a tertiary alcohol, as per this explanation, tertiary alcohols will undergo dehydration most easily. So 20% sulfuric acid, less concentrated sulfuric acid, and temperature would be around 358 kelvins, right? Under these conditions, it will undergo dehydration, right? Under less severe conditions, right? So it will form alcohol, it will form an alkene most easily, right? It will form an alkene here most easily. this alkene will get formed. One hydrogen from here, one OH, right, will get formed. So tertiary alcohol, this is a 3 degree alcohol. This undergoes your dehydration most easily as per this explanation, and we can easily see from experimental condition, less temperature is required and less concentrated acid is required. That means it can undergo dehydration most easily, right? I hope all these points are clear with regards to dehydration of alcohols, right? Now in the next video lecture, we'll look at other reactions of alcohols, oxidation and dehydrogenation reactions, and we'll also look into how to differentiate between different alcohols. Thanks.